Welcome to the Xamarin Show. You're not James.
I'm not James.
I'm not James either. So what's happening?
Well, my understanding is you came all the way from Switzerland to do a show with James.
Yeah. He was all
booked. James isn't here.
And James is like, I'm not going to be here. I'm in Ireland. So James is in Ireland right now. He's, like visiting or looking for leprechaun or something.
Having a good time, apparently.
Probably.
Without us.
Probably. And so basically, James said, well, since you're there and I'm not, why don't you do Xamarin Show? So my name is Laurent Bugnion. I'm a cloud developer advocate. I work for Microsoft. Jeremy?
My name is Jeremy Likness. I am also a cloud developer advocate, and I also work for Microsoft.
Perfect. And so you're on the .NET team. So basically what we have as cloud developer advocates is that we all have some expertise. So my expertise is in Xamarin and .NET. I do a lot of cross-platform. You a little bit less, right?
A little bit less. I haven't really worked with Xamarin.Forms at all, but I do everything .NET based, and I always tell people back in the day I was a huge Silverlight developer, right?
Isn't that Silverlight, this is when we raise our
hand, right? Exactly.
Silverlight. So yeah, Silverlight was awesome. Definitely, they paved the way for a lot of things. Now we have really interesting things in WebAssembly, Blazor, etc. It's not the topic of the show. We'll come back to that another time.
Sure.
But I think really the thing I thought about, initially my idea was to talk about .NET Standard, because .NET Standard, super exciting. It's really cross-platform and really way more than before, because now we can even go on Linux with cross-platform. With .NET Core applications, for example, we can go on macOS, we can go on Windows on all platforms. Super exciting, and it so happens that Xamarin.Forms uses .NET Standard.
Yeah, and I've always wondered, how does that work? Because Xamarin.Forms is a UI thing, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
But it's using .NET Standard that goes Linux, Mac, like
Absolutely.
You said. So excited to learn.
Correct, and so, of course, Xamarin.Forms works on iOS, Android, and Windows UWP, so no Linux here.
Okay.
But I want to show you how it works. So here I have Visual Studio 17 on my machine, and I'm going to create a new project. And so the idea here is that you go on the cross-platform and you select a mobile application for Xamarin.Forms. I'm just going to use the default names. We keep it simple. So that we see something, I'm going to choose a master detail. So basically, this is a template which already has a little bit of data inside so that you can get started. If you want to get started from scratch, you just choose a blank application with nothing at all.
That's the clean slate, and you have to build it up from scratch.
Absolutely. Right. And here at the bottom, we have the platform. So we can choose at the moment Android, iOS, and Windows UWP, so Windows 10, universal Windows platform. And so the really interesting thing for us .NET people is that you can choose a code sharing strategy. So we have shared project. We'll maybe talk about that a little bit more. But what is really interesting for us is this .NET Standard option. So let's create the project. It's going to take a moment to update all the NuGet packages. I mean, this is a standard thing going on. And what you will see created here is four projects. Why four? Well, we have one project per platform. So we selected three platforms. We have UWP, Android, iOS, okay? And those are basically what we call the head projects. They are what you select when you want to say, select it as a startup project, for example, okay? So that's what you're going to create to deploy on your device. And the fourth project, which is the one which is really interesting for us, is this project which is on top here. And this is the shared project where you have everything you need. And mostly what you try to do is that you try to work only in this shared project, because everything you do there is going to be shared.
So less code duplication. And I'm looking at the project, and this is very familiar to me. If you've done WPF or Silverlight, I see our app XAML. I see view models. I see views.
Totally. So this application has already a little bit of data, like I mentioned. So this is, you know, following the model view model pattern, old pattern that we know and love, I hope. And so basically what Xamarin.Forms supports is data binding. We have two-way data binding in the box. And so that's very familiar, like you say, to people who did Silverlight WPF before. It's really well known. So here we have those Android, iOS, and UWP head projects. And inside the shared project, which is really where we want to work, we have a few interesting things. So for example, here, if I expand, let's take the main page.xaml. And as you can see, this is XAML, so this is very familiar. Here in that particular case, we don't have really a binding. But if I go to the item detail page, for example, here we can see that we have some data binding. can make that a little bit bigger. And so this is two-way data binding. In that case, it's a label, so obviously it's a one-way binding. But basically, we are very familiar with that. And so the view models are here in this folder. So again, well-known. Now,
So I was going to ask, the XAML here is in that main project. So you're actually sharing XAML.
Correct.
Across Android, iOS, and UWP.
Correct. So the way that it works is that the controls that you set in the XAML are going to be rendered. Okay. So we have these objects that we call default renderers.
Okay.
And then you can also customize those. So you can create your own renderers. So basically what it says is that a label here in Xamarin.Forms is going to be rendered through a text block in Windows UWP,
okay.
Because on Windows we use text block to
sure.
show text. And then on the other hand, if you go on Android, then it's going to use an Android control called the text view. Now you can change that. So if you're not satisfied with that, you can change it and then you can customize and use any controls that you want instead of that. Or you can say, no, every time I'm on Android, I want the phone to be red.
To be this,
etc.
Yeah. That's very cool.
Yeah. So basically, this is an abstraction, if you want, of the UI. And that's what Xamarin.Forms does.
OK.
Cool. So now we have this. And so now we can actually run the application. So if I go and select, for example, the UWP as a startup project here, OK? And then I'm going to run this with Control F5. And so it's simply going to build the application. It's going to run the application here, and then we'll see that we already have a little bit of data. And then we can do the same on Android as well. So I'm going, while it's starting to just navigate to the application and select it. All right, and then after that, I'll share my screen quickly so that we can see. So here we have the UWP application starting. First,
you know the trick, right? You move your mouse clockwise and that speeds up the
loading. Oh, is that so?
Yeah.
I need to try that out. Yeah. Cool. So here we have the implementation. Okay, we see the items. We can navigate. There is a back navigation, which is, again, right, a UWP feature, but it is used by Xamarin.Forms on UWP. You can add a new item if you want, et cetera, et cetera. So that's working. Now, if we want to show on Android, what I'm going to do is quickly start this application called Visor, which allows me to synchronize my Android phone. Now, you could run it in an emulator if you prefer, right? We support, of course, all the Android emulators. And we also have iOS. And so here, I'm not going to run iOS because I didn't take my Mac with me from Europe all the way. But basically, you can build on the Mac. You know that in Xamarin, you need a Mac to build for iOS. But after that, you can run it on an iOS device or also in the simulator. So here, if I show my phone screen, here we go. And then you see that the application is already running on the phone. And same thing, it's very similar, right? But it is using Android controls, native Android controls. So basically, we are really using native UI, which is good because it is faster. And it is also using user experience paradigms that the user knows, right? Like, for example, it is integrated with, if you have a text field, for example, it supports spell check, etc.
So does it automatically do things like taking menus and collapsing them into hamburgers and?
So you would have to add that.
Okay.
But under the cover, it's using. So if you want to have a drawer for navigation and these kind of things, you can, of course. Those are also controls which exist. And under the cover, it is using the native controls to do that.
Very cool.
Yeah. Cool. So we, you know, seeing the basics of Xamarin.Forms application, I would say, but what is really the interesting for us .NET people is this Xamarin.Forms is using .NET Standard under the cover. So if I go and show the properties of this project, we see that this is a .NET Standard 2.0, right? So now those versions can be a little bit confusing. So do you want to maybe tell us a little bit more about what is a .NET Standard 2.0 versus 1.0 versus what is .NET Core? This is just a little bit confusing for the users. Right.
And I run into this all the time. So basically, we have a little bit of history in .NET development, right, of how we share projects and share code. And in the old days, we'd do it manually. Unfortunately, we would literally copy a link to a file and use that same file, which was pretty inefficient and a maintenance nightmare. And then we got something called Portable Class Library, or PCL. PCL was great because it allowed us to target multiple frameworks, but the way PCL worked was lowest common denominator. So in other words, if you had 15 different frameworks you were targeting, it would find the subset of APIs that all those frameworks used.
Yep.
And the problem with PCL was that the more frameworks you picked, you could pick old versions or new versions, the more you pick, the less surface area you had, the fewer APIs you could call. So what .NET Standard came out and did was it created a target for implementation. It raised the bar. .NET Standard 1.0 said you must implement these interfaces to be .NET Standard 1.0 compliant.
All right. And I think .NET Standard 1.0 was really aimed principally at web things, right? Because they wanted to implement ASP.NET Core. That was really the idea. And why do we want ASP.NET Core? It's because on Azure, we support Linux web servers, right?
Right, which is exactly. Really like the key. Yeah, we want that cross-platform capability to be able to run .NET on commodity servers, if you will, and Linux servers. So .NET Core implemented Standard 1.0, and that allowed us to sort of open the door and say, you know what, we have a lot of different implementations of .NET. Mm-hmm. Any implementation that deals with these APIs can target .NET Standard 1. So then we got 1.6, which brought in a few more frameworks into the family. Mm-hmm. And then when .NET Core 2.0 came out, that coincided with Standard 2.0.
Oh, yeah.
And then other releases and other platforms like Xamarin.
Yeah.
And it just raises that. It added 20,000 APIs.
That's what I heard. And this is really huge, right?
Right.
So it means that finally now we have with .NET Standard 2.0, I would say you can create class libraries that you can really use on client application as well, such as WPF, such as Windows Forms.
Right.
And those are class libraries that you create that you can then use on Linux in a web application if you want, or on Linux in a console application if you want. So if you create utility, etc. And of course, you can also use those class libraries in Xamarin, like we see here, and then run them on iOS and on Android. So it's pretty impressive in terms of cross-platform story. It's quite an impressive story, right?
It is, and in fact, when I first looked at .NET Standard 1.0, I ran into what a lot of people did. It was just such a small API surface area. With 2.0, I was able to take a compression library from 2007.
Wow.
And so this was before people were probably even, well, they probably started thinking about .NET Core, but it was before that was even out.
Yeah.
And by targeting .NET Standard 2.0, it compiles without changing the source code. And you take that DLL, drop it on a Linux machine, and it compresses
files
on that machine.
Yeah. So. No, this is really cool. So I think basically what we can recommend to people who are watching is really take a good look at .NET Standard. If you are using portable class libraries these days, you probably want to start thinking about moving your code to .NET Standard because this is really where Microsoft is going, right? You can still create class libraries, portable class libraries in Visual Studio. It's marked as legacy.
Right.
That kind of should tell you something, right?
It should be a flag.
It's probably a good flag. So people, call to action, really start moving your code, if you can, to .NET Standard. If you have a PCL already, if you have a portable class library, the move is pretty painless. We will put in the show notes a few links. I have a presentation that I gave, which is explaining, you know, how you can do that. I put in my MVVM Light library to, you know, to .NET Standard a few weeks ago. So this is a good thing to watch. And also we have a blog on blog.xamarin.com, which is explaining also a little bit the history of .NET Standard, where it comes from. And so that can be an interesting read for the users. Any closing word? I think we are closing, we are reaching the end of the show.
Sure. The last thing I'll say is there's a lot of NuGet packages that are out there, and not all of them are converted to .NET Standard. Microsoft scanned the packages. We can tell the portability based on the APIs, and we found that 85% of those packages are compatible with .NET Standard 2. Mm-hmm. So there's no reason not to retarget those libraries and share them, because it only helps anyone maintaining the library, because it gives you access to more platforms that library can be used on.
Completely. And by the way, good tip about that. We'll also put that in the show notes. There is also a portability analyzer that Microsoft has published. It's a tool. You run your DLL through that, and it tells you, oh, that particular API that you're using, you might have to change it. But chances are that your code is just going to run, really, because with those 20,000 new APIs, you know, we have a great surface. Cool. Well, thanks so much for joining me. So this was the first Monte Magno-less episode of the Xamarin Show.
Right, and I am not James.
And I'm not James either, but I think we did a good job anyway.
Cool? We did our best.
Cool, thank you. Thank you for watching, and see you next time on the Xamarin Show.